But simplify it to amplify. Bring that story, distill it down into the absolute essential truth, that universal truth that applies to everybody. And I think it's a little bit of a trained skill for people. And this is a point I should have made up higher, but it is, storytelling is a trained skill. It's something that, you know, a lot of people think, oh, that person's a great storyteller. I am not. You can train that skill, like most things, you can train that skill in with just a little bit of work and a few different tips and frameworks. You can become an amazing storyteller. So the idea, you want to oversimplify, and I set this up a little bit higher, but you really want to think of individual stories that are so common that people can understand them. You don't want to go way off into left field that to you know, talk about a story that doesn't make a lot of sense to a lot of people. You want to bring it down to something where I call it a universal truth. You know, it's tripping and skinning your knee, or someone stealing something from you, or cheating on a test when you're in eighth grade and getting caught, or whatever it is. Those kind of everyday moments tend to be the ones that are have the more a shareable aspect to them, so people can see themselves in that story.
Welcome back to another episode of the Heather Sager Show. Today we are talking about storytelling, which is a topic that I am so passionate about. You know, I talk about this all the time. It's one of my signature methods when it comes to speaking on virtual and live stages. I believe that storytelling creates connection unlike any other form of content. But I wanted to bring in a second opinion. I think I could talk about storytelling all day long, as I have on previous podcast episodes, which, side note, if you love the topic of storytelling and you're trying to get better at it, whether you're trying to come up with a more strategic way to tell stories or you need to figure out how to come up with story ideas, I got you. Make sure that you throw back to the episodes I mentioned in this interview of previous episodes I've done around storytelling. All of them are relevant for you, and they are all linked in the show notes. But today, we're going to talk about storytelling specifically from a storytelling strategist who helps brands create their stories to be more compelling in their marketing. So I want to introduce you to Lindsay Raw Rogers. And she began her career as a magazine editor and then moved into freelance journalism, where she traveled around telling other people's stories. But she learned that people loved connection with other people. They loved stories. So she brought that into working with brands. She worked with brands like NBC, Twitter, Toyota, the Olympics, so many other great brands. And now she specifically works with entrepreneurs on their brand story. I had the opportunity to connect with Lindsay inside of another program earlier last year. And I just fell in love with her content, the way that she communicates. She's super smart and strategic around how she captures the essence of stories. So I've asked her to come in and give an outsider's perspective around how storytelling isn't just a fun thing that Heather does. It's actually something that's going to be strategic for you as you connect with more people in your business over the next year. So we're talking about four ways that are mildly surprising that you can use story in your marketing. So she's going to break it down for us. She also has some great acronyms, a lot of hot and tangible tips, which I know you love. So grab a notebook, grab a pen, grab a cup of something, whether if it's something spiked or something warm, or maybe a combo of both, you're going to love this conversation with Lindsay. I hope you enjoy. And if you're thinking about telling your story on virtual, live, or podcast stages this next year, and you're still trying to figure out, how do I connect my story with what I teach? How do I talk about my business in a compelling way to get people to join my programs? You know, that's what we do around here. So now is the time for you to jump into my free training. It's my masterclass that's on demand right now, where you can learn how to build your authority and fill your programs, even if you have a tiny audience, even if you constantly second guess what you say, even if you're used to winging it. I got you. Let's talk about how you can move from winging it with your content into being strategic as a speaker and filling your programs. So you can grab that free training on demand right now at heathersager.com/speak. All right, let's jump into today's interview. I'd like you to meet Lindsay. All All right. Well, Lindsay, welcome to the Heather Sager Show. I am super thrilled that I finally get the chance to have you on the show today. Welcome, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I've been looking forward to it.
Of course. You and I have been talking about this in instant messages on Instagram, where we all hang out and make new best friends for months. And this topic today around storytelling, I know is one my audience loves because they've loved all of the other episodes on storytelling that we've had on the show. Why don't you tell the audience before we jump in and talk about story, why don't you just talk a little bit about yourself, maybe the non-bio version of you, so people know who you are and what you do.
Sure. So I started out as someone at 3 years old who traveled a ton with my family. And I realized at that point when I was really young that stories have this really transformative power where you'd sit around a campfire with people telling you these really fascinating stories. You'd be so engaged. And so I think my path to storytelling started then. And fast forward into a career of journalism where I worked at several different magazines. And then I started working with a lot of different media companies, MSNBC, Yahoo, going on these really big expeditions, sort of in the outdoor industry. And when I was on these expeditions, I also realized I would be sitting in a tent for 5-6 weeks at 15,000 feet with these people trying to climb mountains, and I would be the reporter. That the most compelling thing about that trip was not that I had this like illustrious reporting job, but that when we sat around in the evening listening to all the stories, that was the most interesting part of that entire journey. So it kind of got me interested in storytelling on a whole nother level. So then I started doing a lot of work with brands on how to create story-based, emotion-based storytelling. And so I've worked with a lot of different brands. So I'm going into a little bit of my actual bio, but I've worked with a lot of different brands such as NBC, Twitter. I've done a lot of work on the Olympics bigger brands where we create large amounts of content, but they're heavily based in this idea of storytelling. And now I train entrepreneurs and help entrepreneurs, companies, small businesses discover, unpack, and sort of reveal the power behind their brand story. So if you distill it down to one thing, I sort of bring fidelity to your story for high impact marketing.
Yeah. Okay. That's beautiful. That little line there. There's your one liner for your brand. I love it. I love the fact that you can anchor it back to the campfire stories. Like that in itself, it's very illustrious, right? I can envision all these different memories that I have as a little girl sitting around the campfire with my brothers and sisters, or at girls' camp when I was a teenager. Like, it's fun. Like, and hello, that's the power of stories, as you get other people to think about their memories with it. I'm curious, I don't know if this is public information yet or not. So like, tell me if I'm stepping in something here, but you mentioned you recently were able to do some storytelling with Laura Belgray. Didn't you write up an article with her?
I did. It's being published, I think, hopefully next week in Business Insider. So she and I connected because we have a very different background, but we're both in this kind of writing world. So I reached out to her. I love her writing. It's very different than my style of writing, which I always appreciate and learn from. And so I reached out to her saying, hey, let's figure out a way to chat and see if there's a way we can collaborate. And so I interviewed her, and I'm way more comfortable in the interviewer seat versus the interviewee seat. So it was great. It was really exciting. And we did sort of an as told to article for Business Insider that's coming out the next week or two.
I love it. Okay. So by the time this episode's aired, that should be live. So we will link to that in the show notes, along with everything we're going to talk about today. And you can connect with Lindsay here on the show. So here's what I'm most excited about as we're going to break it down today. What we're talking about is four ways to use stories in your brand. There's a lot of different ways we're going to tackle it. I'm really excited about this. So my audience knows I love storytelling. I talk about storytelling all the time. My experience with stories is as a storyteller. So everything that I've learned about stories has come from my own experience telling stories as a kid. I had a huge imagination, and telling stories from the stage, just finding that works. So mine's been like an inside out job. Like, I started by being a storyteller, reading my audience to figure out what works and what doesn't. And then eventually I started actually learning more about storytelling, what works. What I thought was fascinating about your experience is you are more of like an outside in, where you study stories and help other people craft stories. And through that, you've created your story. So I thought this would be kind of like a fun yin and yang around two different perspectives around storytelling. So let's talk a little bit about, for those listening who are going, Heather, I know story is important, but I still think there's a hesitancy sometimes for people to go, how do I actually use them, or where and why should I use them? So what's your philosophy when it comes to storytelling?
So just to provide a little bit of context, I'm going to get a little bit nerdy right now on storytelling. So
welcome here.
it's sort of what I do, obviously. So I'm going to get nerdy and give you an acronym to try to remember. And it helps you figure out, okay, there is a reason behind storytelling. There is a reason that people connect with stories. There's a reason that our brains connect with stories, and not just, physically when you hear something, you react, but emotionally, there's actually things going on in neurologically with chemicals that actually change when you hear a story. So here's the acronym. Story. It's not that surprising. So the S stands for social. So stories have this innate social component because they're told from one person to another person. It's a way to find this common bond, share useful information, or allow us to kind of learn. And originally, way back when, it allowed us to survive and thrive. It allowed us to say, oh, here are the strategies we need to avoid the woolly mammoth coming into my cave. So it's built into our DNA to receive stories as a way to kind of survive and thrive. T is tension. So the cornerstone of stories is that they highlight this tension. And tension, when it's presented, sort of captures the imagination, keeps us engaged, captures our attention. And we want to know what happens to that character if there's this sort of before and after tension. So O in the story, S-T-O-R-Y, is order. So stories have this ability to order specific things in a specific sequential order so that your brain can wrap around, okay, this happened, then this happened, then this happened. So it helps you understand, okay, I can learn from this. I get how that person got from A to B. When you look at kind of the neurology side of things, they've done a lot of studies around this, and stories are 22 times more memorable than facts, which is one of the reasons why I try to share stories a lot, because it helps people remember things. The R in story is relatability. So I was talking a little bit about these neurochemicals. So stories fire up this part of the brain that allows us to see ourselves in someone else's story. So you can relate to that other person's story, which is why you want to be highly personal. So when you're telling stories, if you're selling something that someone else experienced but you didn't, it's not as relatable. So you want to allow people to see themselves in your story. And then the Y is you. It's a really important factor to involve you, yourself, in these actual stories to make it highly personal and therefore relatable. So that's a little bit of context as to why stories are important. And then I'm happy to hop in.
I love it. I think the fact, okay, so stories. So S, social, T, tension, O, order, R, relatability, and Y, you. First of all, I'm taking mild offense that you called an acronym geeky, because I love acronyms, but I'm also super geeky. So I love it. And I think this serves as a little bit of a checklist for people who think, okay, what does my story need to have in it? Like at the end of the day, when we say story, I think it's really easy for people to, I don't know, have these big grand delusions of what a story is. It just needs to include some of these elements. So I love this. It's not geeky. It's actually really helpful. And I hope for those listening, if you didn't write that down, rewind back, write it down, and or it's in the show notes. So click on the show notes and I just type that all up for you. You can have that. You could take a picture of it and keep it on your phone. Okay. So when it comes to story, that's our context, right? This, we know why stories matter and how to use them. Let's actually talk about placement of stories and how to be more strategic using them as a brand. So I think this is the fun part we're talking today. I talk about using storytelling from stages, whether that's on social, whether that's on virtual event stages or on podcasts, et cetera. You're talking about strategies for marketing, which may or may not include some stages, but let's dive into the four ways to use stories, because I think this is going to get people's like idea lights flashing. It was a terrible way to phrase it, but you know what I mean, right? Like light bulbs going off. I think we want to get people thinking about, okay, how can I apply this more than just in my signature talk? So let's dive into the four ways to use stories.
Okay. So I wanted to give you a couple of surprising ideas, because most people say use stories in your social, use stories in Instagram stories, use stories on YouTube, use stories in your talks. Okay. That's great. But when you back into that a little bit and say, okay, but that's what's the first step? Like, where do I use them? That's a little bit surprising. What are the techniques that I can use to have a compelling story? So these are sort of four less known ways, or sort of unconventional ways that we want to use stories. First one is we want to talk about testimonials and social proof. And a lot of people do testimonials in a funny way, where they just say, okay, here's why Heather's speak up
so
to level
amazing.
Up impacted
and Heather's so incredible and amazing.
Exactly. That's who changed my entire life. So they want to say that, but what they miss is this sort of personal story of the transformation, right? The difference between what was and what is now. So I always like to have people show an arc in testimonials of what is or what was, and what could be or what is now. So show that transformation. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, when you're collecting testimonials, you want to think of this as sort of anecdotal evidence that will enable other people's growth, because they can then see themselves in this testimonial. Just like we were talking about above, they want to be able to say, oh, she experienced that, he experienced that. I could see myself in those shoes and going through that same thing. I can see myself having that same transformation. I'm going to go take Heather's course or whomever it is. So it sort of has this like FOMO effect of marketing. So fear of missing out effect of marketing, when you have a testimonial with a before and after. So that's the thing there. In each testimonial, I want you to think of four different things. So the first tip is, the goal of any testimonial is to elicit an emotion. Okay. So I'm just going to give you a quick example and then we'll move on from this one. But so Spartan is this race series, right? And they say they turn quitters into people who commit. And I love that, because it gives you this like, oh, I'm a quitter. No, if I do this, I'm going to be that person who commits. So it gives you this like aspirational idea who you could be. So their tagline is, I'm just reading what their tagline is, a catalyst for transformation. So they want to elicit this feeling of accomplishment, even though it's sort of in the face of extreme physical adversity. So that's an example of, okay, you want to elicit this emotion in someone. The second one is that you want to highlight, like I said, this before and after transformation, because it gives people an idea of what their journey could actually look like. So it highlights this one moment, this one key kind of transformational moment that will give people a context of the event that happened for them. So the third tip is, you want to end first. So you want to start with a story that has the end result first. So that encourages this person to lead with their experience of how they were transformed. So start with the end. A little confusing. And then the last thing is, people get really tripped up on, oh, I need to create this massive, crazy story that's was one time in my life it happened. And the actual thing, the stories that are the most interesting and compelling are the simplest stories, or the everyday moments. So I say simplify to amplify. I sort of stole that a little bit. I think it was from Marie Forleo. But simplify to amplify. Bring that story, distill it down into the absolute essential truth, that universal truth that applies to everybody.
I love that. And maybe Marie said it, but also thousands of other people have said that too. So I think you're good there.
Good.
Okay. I love the fact that the first place you're talking about for using stories is through testimonials, because this is such a hot topic, especially for coaches, course creators, and service providers. The thing that sells our programs and products more than anything else is the stories of other people. But the miss most people make is they think testimonial is praise for the program, which it is not. I think this idea around, you actually want to share stories that, like, the experience people have had and what it's created for them. So just off the top of my head, since those of you who are listening, your podcast listeners, if you actually go back on the podcast to episode 71, You'll hear one of my Speak Up to Level Up clients share her story, which is a testimonial for Speak Up to Level Up, but it's her story around how the title is the transformation, how speaking helped a new business owner launch her offer. The result was she was able to launch her offer and now she's selling out her program, but she used a program to do that. So that's a great example of someone's story serving as a testimonial. I think we need to do more of this. I think people use testimonials as praise. They are not praise. They're for other people to see themselves through another person because they might not identify with you and your journey, but they sure as hell will identify with someone else who might be more similar in experience and skill set and place on the path as the person telling the testimonial.
That's right. That's right. Exactly. Yeah. It gives people context rather than just kind of fire hosing them with, here's how great I am.
Yeah. You know, side note, I'm going to go on a little Sager side note here for a second. I was listening in a Clubhouse room earlier this week that had some really big hitters in the course creation space. Amy Porterfield was one in the room and somebody was talking, I think it was a little bit after she left, somebody was talking about how, you know, I love learning from Amy. She's the OG of online marketing. She goes, but I feel bad saying this, but sometimes I don't necessarily identify with her story because she's so much further along than me. Mm-hmm. And side note, if you listen to Amy Porterfield's content, this is exactly why she shares so many of her student stories, because exactly. She knows that her story isn't going to like pull in their connection. They're not as far with her on the journey. So she leverages this so well in her marketing because she knows people don't identify with where she's at in her multiple million-dollar business 12 years in. She has to tell different stories. So this is where she does it.
That's right. And she also works very hard at telling her own personal stories. And I don't think that's the most comfortable for her. And she says it out loud. Admittedly, she says, I'm not very comfortable here. I don't like telling you this. I mean, I think she said that in a post the other day. I don't want to tell you that I just moved to Nashville and I'm really uncomfortable. I'm out of my element. I don't know what to do. And I'm sharing it. And I think it's a little bit of a trained skill for people. And this is a point I should have made up higher, but storytelling is a trained skill. It's something that, you know, a lot of people think, oh, that person's a great storyteller. I am not. You can train that skill. Like most things, you can train that skill in with just a little bit of work and a few different tips and frameworks. You can become an amazing storyteller. And she, again, is a great example of working hard at it every day.
Yeah, good, really, really good insight there. Okay, so that's way number one. So use stories and testimonials to create social proof. What's the second way we can use stories in our marketing?
So the second way, I'm going to really geek out again, bring you back to probably middle school or maybe high school grammar, where do you remember the idea of a parable? So a parable is basically sort of a fabricated story that makes a point, it sort of illustrates the point that you're trying to make. So creating a parable for what you do, for example, is a really good idea because it allows you, if someone asks on the street, you know, what do you do for work? And you don't have a story like ready to go, or you're trying to get a customer, you're trying to land a partnership, and people aren't totally understanding what you do, you can create this bridge that sort of, I think people call it a kind of like bridge. So it's this idea where you create a fabricated story that other people can connect with to illustrate a point. So I'm going to give you an example.
Yes, please.
So when people ask me what I do, I tell this story where probably a year or two ago, I was chatting with a friend of mine who just became a partner in a law firm. And I said, oh my gosh, that sounds awful. That sounds like a lot of hours and an insane life that I would not want to live. But I really want to know, in law school and throughout your career, what was the one thing that they taught you that you can apply in everyday life? And she said, oh, I know the exact thing. I know that when you're in law school, they give you 4,000 to 6,000 words to read per night. And your job as a lawyer, a lawyer in training, is to distill those 4,000 to 6,000 words down into one sentence or one point. And you're going to make that point when you're arguing your point tomorrow in your class. So when I explain what I do, I basically do what they did in law school. You have tens of thousands of stories in your lifetime. And I help you distill down those tens of thousands of stories into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 really compelling points. So that's an example of using a parable to make a point of what I do, for example. So again, a parable is this sort of like fabricated, made up story, but it gives you an opportunity to sort of wrap your own story in this cloak that other people understand, because not everyone is going to have your experience. Not everyone is going to be grow up a ski racer like I did. So if I tell ski racing stories, they're going to look at me sideways like, oh, I hate snow. So it gives you an opportunity to find a really common bond with people through the use of a fabricated story. And it can come in handy in a lot of different places, but whether you're pitching to investors, again, you're trying to find a partnership, you are on the street telling people what you do, you're starting a talk. In your case, you know, when you're training people to like how they introduce themselves, a parable is a really, really helpful way to have this kind of like or imagine if bridge to allow people to understand.
I love this. I've never thought about a parable before. I think about parable. I think about, what were they called? Fables?
Those, right, exactly.
The childhood stories. I'm like, the little boy that cried wolf. We're talking about that a lot in my house right now with my almost six-year-old. What's the difference between an analogy and a parable?
So we're going to get confused between an analogy, a metaphor, and a parable. So if you think of a metaphor and a parable, you can kind of put into one bucket where there's it gets really tricky really quickly because they're sort of analogous experiences. So they're kind of these experiences that highlight, or a story that kind of highlights a point. An analogy, actually, you do this quite well because you've done things and you pepper them in really well. I think a handful of episodes ago, I was listening to you. You were talking about throwing a three-pointer.
Yeah.
And say, you know, it's like standing way far back on the court and you throw a three-pointer. Think of that, where it's like giving people this way to connect with what you're talking about without actually understanding the actual thing you're talking about. So that's kind of this like metaphorical experience that you're giving
them. So I do analogies all the time. My favorite thing is, I didn't realize this was my thing, but it's my thing. This is how people introduce me as the girl who has the most crazy, ridiculous, but they totally work analogies. So in my head, I'm going, okay, so how do I have analogies, got that down. In my head, I'm still going, okay, so a parable, it's like out of context, fictitious story or real story?
Oftentimes it can be both, but so oftentimes a parable is a made up story. So oftentimes it's something where you say, I think you used one where you're saying, you know, imagine there's like holes in the boat and you're leaking water out of the bottom of the boat. So there's this kind of allegorical aspect to you're sort of making up this story to illustrate an actual point. So it's a sort of a side-by-side comparison saying, I want to make this point. I'm going to make it in a way that other people can understand, even though it is completely fictitious and made up.
Got it. So they're really similar. Analogies and parables are similar, but the parable, I almost said parallel, which it is a parallel when you think about it. It seems like it's a little bit more elaborate, a little bit more established, probably a little longer version of that. It's like, would it be like taking an analogy and making it more of a story?
That could be. I mean, I might have to actually look up the distinction.
Or maybe we're getting into here. Like, it's just the idea. Use out of context examples.
That's right.
These parables, whatever you want to call it. But by the way, I love this tip, because I think so many people try to focus on having stories be so like on the nose. Like, how do I have the perfect story to describe what I'm trying to do? And in fact, the perfect story is actually the thing that you don't need. You need something out of context. So I like this. It gives people other ways to come up with it.
Yeah. And I'll give you a few tips on how to use this. So the first one is exactly to your point. You sort of did the layup for me on this one, but so to oversimplify.
Look at that. A three-pointer and a layup. Look at us like doing.
And sports. I don't even play basketball. Barely touched basketball in my life. I'm a ski racer. The idea, you want to oversimplify. And I set this up a little bit higher, but you really want to think of individual stories that are so common that people can understand them. You don't want to go way off into left field to talk about a story that doesn't make a lot of sense to a lot of people. You want to bring it down to something where I call it a universal truth. You know, it's tripping and skinning your knee, or someone stealing something from you, or cheating on a test when you're in eighth grade and getting caught, or whatever it is. Those kind of everyday moments tend to be the ones ones that are have the more a shareable aspect to them, so people can see themselves in that story.
I love that.
So
I love that term, universal truths. I think that's a really great way to put that. Like, I think that's beautiful. I love it.
Perfect. So number two is make the connection. So when you are talking to people about, hey, here's my story, here's my parable, what you want to do is you want to have sort of a lesson in that, and you want to make that point out loud. So you don't want to let them create that connection. You want to make that connection for them. So yes, say why this matters, why you're telling them this story and why it matters. So make the point. Because a lot of people, they'll do email marketing, for example, and they'll tell a story, period. And there's no point. And that's tough because there's no payoff. So you want to make sure there's a payoff. And so you make the connection for them for that payoff.
Yes.
It's great in email marketing. It's great all over the place, but make sure there's a payoff. Three is, and this is sort of the oversimplification as well, is use commonplace metaphors. So lean on those things that are impossible for people to confuse. It is the skin knee. It is the, seeing someone drop, I'm looking at my mailbox, seeing someone drop mail in. What does that mean that everyone can experience? And then the last one is be creative. So think outside the box, and you can look these up all day long. I mean, parables historically can be a little bit more kind of fables, but think of little stories throughout your life. And I always tell people that creating sort of the story vault, and I think you have talked about this in the past, but create a story vault where something happens to you, you kind of think of, oh, there's a little bit of a connection there to what I do for work. I'm going to write that down in my notes app. I'm going to write it down in, you know, an Excel spreadsheet. And then the other thing I would do if you do have a story vault is create a term vault. Because oftentimes, I just wrote about this in an email the other day, is when you sit down to write an email, you sit down to write a social post, you sit down to write something and you are blank. You go blank. Everyone does it. Everyone has that experience. So when you have this story vault and you have this term vault, you say, okay, I have the story, but now I need to make the connection. How I heard this on the podcast, and I really like the way Tim Ferriss said X, Y, and Z. That was a really interesting turn of phrase. So you can connect those two, and now you have your story for email. So it's a really helpful thing because we all have a black box upstairs sometimes that's locked.
Yes,
oftentimes it's inaccessible.
Yeah. So for those of you thinking, okay, story vault, I've heard that before. I'm curious about building that. If you guys scroll it back to episode number 58, I teach you how to come up with a bank of stories for your content. And I teach you how to create your own story vault so that you never run out of stories, and also banish the excuse of, I don't have any stories. We solve all of that in episode 58.
Perfect. Yeah. That is a common question I get a lot, is how do I come up with stories every single week for my email, et cetera. That story bank, story vault, and term vault. I would add that in because it's an important thing to, it can jog you really quickly to say, ooh, I really like the way they said that. I'm going to use that.
I love that. Yeah. Okay. So ways to use stories. We've gone over use stories and testimonials and social proof. Number one. Number two, use parables to get buy-in, which are kind of like metaphors and or analogies, but a little bit more beefed up. And then way number three, go for it.
Okay. So this one, I really like the idea of this because it allows you to lean on the kind of historical learnings that you've had, because we've all lived a complex life with a lot of different interactions with people, a lot of successes, a lot of failures, a lot of ups, a lot of downs. We've all been through a lot, right? So you want to leverage the pain of the past to tell really effective stories. So I was listening to a podcast not too long ago, and I think it was Jay Shetty's podcast, and he was interviewing a guy named Ray Dalio. And he said something awesome that I really, really like. And he said, pain plus reflection equals progress. So if you are sharing something painful that you had, and then you share, oh, this is how I synthesized it internally, this is how I changed, this is how I created what I created, this is why, that reflection piece is an amazing story. So sharing that reflection is a key piece of connecting with people, because they want to know, oh, you've been through kind of the muck too. You've had to swim through oil and get you've gotten tarred and feathered just like me. I want to know that you've been through that and you survived on the other end. So you want to leverage that pain and those lessons that you've experienced from the past. And it also sort of allows you to understand like the cause and the effect of your internal motivation. So here here's why, and here's what I did about it. And it helps other people say, oh, interesting. Okay, you've been through that. I have sort of the same reward system internally where I went through something similar. And now I have turned it into a lesson that I use every single day. So think about the struggle of overcoming this pain as a really awesome place to get stories from. It's almost a way to say, okay, I'm going to add to my story vault by thinking of all the pain I've been through. And again, we've been through enough. We've had, for me personally, babies and miscarriages and, failed attempts at businesses and it's terrible boyfriends and all that stuff. So think about those individual pain points and how you can turn those into an actual lesson or building block of your life.
I love that. I want to point out one of the things you said and then give us a couple tips here.
Sure.
One of the things that you were talking about is there, like, the pain happens. The pain that happens isn't necessarily the story. It's the reflection and the insights that you experience internally. That's the story. And I think this is I want to call attention to this because this is a really common question I get from clients or students inside my program, that they've walked through something and they know there's a story there, but they don't quite know how to tell it. And what they want to focus on, oh, you brought up miscarriage. I've gone through miscarriage too. The actual miscarriage itself, yes, there's the element of that is the story, but the story is more of the how we grapple with that internally. Like, so the feelings of our body not being able to do the things it should, or the second guessing our decision to do an activity that we think caused a miscarriage, but of course it didn't. It's the reflection of it, what we made it mean, how we internalized it. That's the story that people identify with, not just the thing that happened in itself. And I think so many times people want to recite fact around, here's the sequence of events that happened. That's not the story. That's not the identifiable piece. It's that reflection piece and what's going on internally. So I thought that was a really beautiful insight. And I think it's going to be really helpful for people who are thinking about how do I share from my heart without it being so heavy.
That's right. That's right. I think it's a good point made. And I do think a lot of people get tied up in that sequential order of the story as being the thing, like you said, and it's what they know how to do. It's common. So what I would urge people to do is sort of untie that learning a little bit, open it up and try to think, okay, let me think of the lesson first. And then I'm going to back into the points of the story that make sense as they relate to that lesson and that reflection that I've had. So almost think reflection first, story second.
Yes. Okay. I love that. Okay. And you had a couple tips around telling the vulnerable stories, right?
Yeah. So one thing that I like to talk about is the first thing is you want to bleed first. So start with the bleeding of whatever happens. So let's say you're telling a story about, like, I actually have a Muslim client right now where she was creating this huge origin story about how she kind of came to create, she's creating an app for Muslim families on how to educate their kids and keep their kids sort of spiritually in line, if you will, with their Muslim faith. And she had so much in there that was really interesting, but there was a long lead up and then there was some context and there's a long, so I cut 97% of the story and I cut to this very specific point, this turning point that was, I was lost. I didn't know what to do. And it really captures people right up front. Because if you start with that moment, that kind of, that bleeding, that evocative moment, that emotional time when it was like, oh, I didn't know what to do, or I was about to fill in the blank, something that is really, really evocative, then people will, it'll capture people's attention. Mm. So bleed first.
Okay. I love that. I'm immediately thinking about, we all know how this plays out on television or in movies, right? We all know the movies or the television shows where it cuts right to this moment. I'm thinking like Grey's Anatomy right now, where there's like this crazy thing happening in the ER and you're like, wait, how the hell did this, like, what is happening? And it's like, pause. And then it's like, rewind back 36 hours in time. Like, that's when right. You cut to that moment of tension, when you cut to that thing that's going to hook someone's attention, you do it in movies, they do it on TV. You can also do that with your storytelling. I think it's really, really effective, especially online when we have such short attention spans. I think that's a beautiful thing. I think a lot of people think that they have to give a ton of context, and context is necessary. That's one of my core words, but it's not always critical. So talk a little bit about that. I know that's one of your tips, is giving the context.
Yeah. So giving context, I do think you're right. People overdo the context a little bit. And what I would want you to think about is answering four really, really simple questions when you give context. And I'm talking half a sentence each and having these kind of meld into one or two sentences when you're telling a story is who, what, when, and why. So when you think about hooking people, and you're exactly right, things like movies, books, they all do this. They kind of bleed first, then they kind of go back and share context and then get you to back to that bleeding.
Yeah.
So you want to create these really concrete details and you want to do, so answer those four questions. But as soon as you're done with that, don't go overboard, make it really simple for people to understand, allow them to see themselves in that context, move on. It's really quick.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I love that. And I always say, I'll give like a visual here when I'm coaching clients on stories. I think there's what happens, a good recipe for a story. You have the before, you have a moment that happens that's like the significant thing, and then you have an after. And I think a lot of people think that they have to be equal in their time, meaning they have to spend as much time on the before as they do on the after. And I'm like, those three things are not equal amounts of time. You need to allocate the appropriate amount of time to the before, the moment, and the after. Some stories, the moment is going to be most of the story. It's going to be 90% with like a little bit of time on the before and a little tiny bit of time after. Some stories are going to be all about the after, which just a tiny little context on the before. There's no right recipe, in my opinion, for like the perfect time allocation of the story, but every story has to have those three, the before, the moment, and the after. But you have to play around with how much time are you going to give to the context versus save for the actual like meat of the after. It depends on your story. But I think we need to be thinking about those things. Otherwise, we are disrespecting our audience's time and they hate that. They won't stick around for the payoff. I love that you used that phrase. I use it all the time. Is there a payoff that's equitable to the time invested in the story?
Yeah. And I would start, that's why I think you start with a payoff, right? You sort of start with the end in mind when you're creating a story, and whether you're telling a story on stage or wherever you are, start with a payoff, the end, and think, okay, how can I back into this? How can I provide context to it? That's just enough. Because to your point, people's attention spans are so short right now that I'm sure, you know, stories, when you're, to bring back Tim Ferriss, when you're listening to his podcast, it can be 2.5 hours long, or Rich Roll, they can be 2.5 hours long. That's amazing if you have time. But if you're trying to get people's attention really quickly, you have to provide context fast. So if it's in an about us, if it's an actual blog post, an email, anything, you want to think of, and I know Russell Brunson sort of talks about this with ClickFunnels, but he says hook, story, offer. So what's your hook? That's bleeding first. Then you think of this story, that's a little bit of providing context. And then he says offer, I say lesson. So think of kind of that lesson or that payoff first, and then back into the other two pieces after that.
Yeah. Okay. I love that. I love that. Also, everybody has their own framework for the same thing. So I call this my ABC model for storytelling. It's mm-hmm. A, attract your audience with some kind of hook and story. B, mm-hmm. the bridge, which is what's the point of the story and how do you connect the dots, to C, which is your content. What's the actual right piece of content you want to teach? So it's fascinating to me that we all have our own little versions of this, but all roads lead back to the same thing. Get organized in how you talk about your stuff.
That's right.
Okay. I love that. All right. So that kind of closes out are being more like telling vulnerable stories. The tip was how to, or the way to use story, how to leverage the pain of the past. So using real vulnerable shares. Let's go into way number four to use stories in your branding.
Okay. So oftentimes what people do when they're either creating a company or they're pivoting a company, or maybe they're an entrepreneur new to a particular space, is they have this big brand vision or company vision of, okay, here's what I want to be. Here's who I am. I'm going to tell everybody. But what they don't do is they don't articulate a visual that people can wrap their heads around, because words can do a lot, right? Stories can do a lot. But unless you paint a picture of what that looks like, they're not going to be able to see themselves in it. So I like to say there's this gap. So create a visual between what you do and the vision for your company. So this is a little bit of a lesson in persuasion. So how can you persuade someone to believe in you, right? So the answer is by sort of showing them that your brand viscerally impacts their lives. So when you think about this idea of persuasion, one of the main goals for us as humans, whether it's kind of conscious or not, is to persuade people to like us so we can influence them, right? I mean, it's a lot of what you talk about. You want to be accepted, you want to be revered for something that has meaning. So when you are thinking about creating a visual for people, you want to say, okay, what is it that would give them meaning? What gives me meaning? And you want to kind of share those individual pieces of where you are and where you are going with your company in a very visceral, visual way. So there's something that there's a couple of stats that I wanted to share just because I think they're sort of interesting. So one is we're sort of hardwired to recognize ideas that reinforce what we already believe and sort of reject what we don't. And that's a key for persuasion, right? And so the stat that I want to bring up is, and I'm just going to read it right here, is so 71% of consumers prefer buying from brands who share their values. So when you think of a visual, you want to architect a visual for what your values are. Because when you're talking about millennials specifically, a large portion of them say that it's really, really important for them to buy from companies that align with their values and their beliefs. So aligning your values and beliefs by architecting this visual for people is really, really key, especially if you're going after sort of the younger generation of people. My generation and older is a little bit more cut and dry, but when you're going after younger, kind of more millennials, they really hang on the idea of brand values. And if they don't believe in you, they will not buy from you. I'm happy to go into kind of these four steps.
I'm curious. Can you give an example or maybe the client you've worked with around how you would integrate your values into a story?
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to bring up this kind of Muslim client again. So she went through this really big story about how she came to this idea of creating this app for Muslim families. And it was important for her as her own family. One of her values was that when she was young, she was taught all of these lessons in the Muslim faith. But as she grew up and she saw her kids integrating kind of with Western culture, she saw that they weren't as interested in this Muslim faith. And so they would go be attracted to Disney and they would go be attracted to their friends at soccer practice. They wouldn't pray, whatever it was. And I'm not espousing any religion. I'm not actually religious myself, but just to tell her story, what was really, really important to her is to share her value of, I want to embed this element of spirituality into my kids and have it be something that comes naturally and not forced upon them. Like I'm kind of a wet blanket on them all the time. And so in her story, she painted a visual of what that looks like in her family. And so it looks like, you know, I have 10 questions that I ask them every time I sit down at the dinner table. In the morning, instead of just hounding them to pray, we have this process that we walk through that we connect with. Those are her values. And so she tells these stories of how the values play out in her life. And then it says to people, oh, she knows what she's talking about. She's investigated this really heavily and now she knows how to do it. And so she talks about her values and so in her kind of about us and why on her website. And she does it through stories of her values.
Okay. I love this. Instantly my brain is going with ideas, but I think so the idea of values, everyone loves to talk about them. They love to make the list of values, maybe even put them on their website. But the idea of application, if you think about that exact thing, if you have a value, you think about how do you demonstrate this value or how have you demonstrated this value in your life? And then telling a story related to that. I can just see like little bonus here. I could easily see business owners right now going, okay, what are a couple of my values? How can I share a little bit of the story and make that a few social media captions over the next month? You can infuse your values through story in your social captions. And this is a way to show your values. People can understand who you are without going, in our company, we value integrity. We value authenticity. Whatever the list is, that doesn't mean anything. The story to demonstrate what it actually looks like, what it feels like, that's where people actually say, ooh, that company gets me. People are not looking for a checklist to say, do you believe these things? They're looking for the demonstration of values, and stories is a great way to do it.
Yeah. And there's another one that comes to mind that I was just studying. I'm creating this kind of video for a large brand in the construction world right now. And we were looking at videos that were really compelling that show values as stories and through video. And so you don't have to do this through words. You can also do this through video. It's a really, really compelling format right now. So we were looking at one from Airbnb trips. And what they did is they started in a moment where they came into someone's house, they woke up, they turned the light on, and then it walked through all these different pieces of how someone experiences their day if they're going into a new place. And they distilled it down to, it's not about the whole experience of going to a new place is about experiencing the people of that place. Mm-hmm. And so that's for Airbnb, it's about sharing people, not just, yeah, you get a bed in someone's home, but sharing the experiences of the locals, of the people behind San Francisco, behind, you know, Austin, Texas, wherever it is. So that's an example of, you know, someone, a big company like Airbnb, showcasing their values through saying, we believe that the people are the reason behind what we do.
Yeah. Okay. I love this. I love that we're ending on this one of talking about infusing values through stories. Why don't you share a couple tips to help people do this more successfully?
Sure. So the first one is a little bit easier said than done, but it's worth the exercise. So the idea is, you know, what are your core values? And this can be a whole nother episode in and of itself, but what do you or your company live by? Is it, you know, something like efficiency, productivity? Is it authenticity? Is it diversity? Do you want to elicit something from someone? Is that one of your values? Like, I want to elicit empathy or curiosity. Do you want to be perceived as adventuresome, you know, et cetera. So the first is get really, really crystal clear on your values. Write them down somewhere. I would say try to keep them between 3 and 5, not any more than that. You want to distill them down to something very, very simple. Then you want a next step in that. So this isn't necessarily tips, this is sort of steps, is the second step would be to nail down your customers' values. So you have your values. What are your customers' values? I would imagine hopefully they're similar things, but how you want to map those together is through story. So again, to bring back the Airbnb, what's important to the people who travel to use Airbnb? They want to get to know the people, they want to experience the place, they want to feel comfortable, they want to feel like they're in a home, all those things. So they shared a story that elicited emotions around feeling at home, feeling like they belong in a place, feeling like they're going to share those experiences with locals. So create and map the stories that connect those two values, the values of your customers and your values. And lastly, what I would say is be really precise and specific with your stories. And the beautiful thing about stories is they're endless. You can create new stories all the time. And based upon your experience, or if you change your company's values, or you go through something bigger, or you pivot your company, those stories are sort of, it's like a never-ending fire hose that you can always come back to and recreate. So when you're thinking about being specific with your story, I know people say, oh God, how do I nail one down? And how do I retell that? You don't have to retell it. You can tell new stories all the time, but you want to think about concrete details. So you don't just say, you know, our vision for the company is to impact people in a positive way. Like that's really boring. And people don't really know what that means. That doesn't manifest as something. So you want to take that one step further and say, okay, well, what does it mean to impact people in a positive way? Be precise with that. Be exact and specific in telling your story. So whether that's giving people sort of a before and after, or show them how their lives would be different through a series of mini stories that showcase your values. But you want to give people these kind of like concrete and original details.
Ooh, that's so good. That precision piece is such a good tip. I just think about in general with marketing, I think a lot of times people explain what they do in far too generic terms. So stories, what you're talking about, gives the opportunity to be more clear with who you work with, how you work with them, having those little like precision stories, that's gold. I looked up while you were talking about the values piece. I know this is a I feel like values has made a very forward conversation in 2020. More and more people are talking about it, and more people are recognizing that people make decisions based off of company values, in terms of what companies, exactly what you said, which companies to work with. So for anybody listening who's still struggling with what truly are their values and wanting to explore that a bit, if you head back to episode 48, where I had a diversity and inclusion expert, Erica Corday, we had a great conversation. It's called Listening and Learning and Acting in the Way of a Changemaker. We talked about core values. We talked about diversity and inclusion, if that's a priority for you as you think about your businesses here. She's got some exceptional tools around setting values for your company. And I think pairing this episode with that will help you start pulling the right values into your business and now tell stories that demonstrate your values.
Perfect. Yeah, that's helpful.
I love that. All right. So we've covered a lot of ground in a pretty short amount of time today, Lindsay. I love this. I feel like you have really gifted us with a lot of specific but tangible details that'll help people put storytelling into practice in a strategic way. So leveraging it, not just by telling stories, but where to tell stories in their business. So let's summarize these four ways for us. Will you break them down again for us?
Okay. So the first way is you want to think about your acronym of story. So that's context for why you want to tell stories, period. So I know you highlighted these, but we'll just say social, tension, order, relatability, and you. So make sure you have you in there. So the four places, sort of the surprising unconventional places that you want to think about embedding stories are testimonials as social proof. And together, that's a strong combo. Do you want me to go through all the tips as well?
Why don't you just hit the highlights and then go to the show notes to get all the details.
Okay. Second one is how to use parables to get buy-in. So use parables or fabricated stories to get buy-in for a fast yes, so people can understand what you do. The third one is leveraging the pain of the past. So make sure you understand your stories, but reflect on those. The reflection of those stories is what's most key for leveraging the pain of the past. And the last one is you want to close the gap between your brand vision and your brand visual. So creating a visual for people for what you do from the framework of what are your values as a company.
Okay. Amazing. And you were so generous with your time for walking these through us, but you also have a resource that can help people actually navigate these four, right?
Yes. Yes, I do. So if you didn't have time to listen to this whole thing, there's tons more in a downloadable freebie you can get at Raw. My company is Raw Strategy. So it's rawstrategy.net/marketing-stories.
Perfect. And I'll be summarizing what we talked about today in the show notes, but in her resource document, Lindsay goes even further with these so that it can help you, even if you listen to the whole thing, which you are, if you're listening to this at this point in time, download it. I find that I consume podcast episodes on the go and I'll take one thing and remember it, but things that really matter in my business, which side note, storytelling and connecting with your audience should matter. Those are things worth coming back to. So having a resource to help with that. So link to grab that PDF download is in the show notes. You can grab it. Lindsay, I want to ask you this kind of last closing question. I'm going to catch you off guard a little bit, but I want to close with this. Mm-hmm. I always find on social media stages or on podcast interviews, people always ask like the common questions around the topic we speak on, but there's always other things we want to talk about that we wish somebody would ask us about. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious, like if you think about talking about storytelling or thinking about branding, what's one thing that you wish people would be talking about with stories, but it's just not a common thing. It's not being discussed, but you wish it was.
I think my mind goes to one thing first, and it actually has to do with mindset around stories, because people are not innately vulnerable around their stories. And the more vulnerable you get and the more personal you become with those stories, the better. But there is this sort of shift internally, because when you think about stories in a academic way, it's yes, we connect with stories. It's how we transfer knowledge. It is how we learn things. It's how we sort of, as I said at the beginning, survive and thrive. But to be able to be comfortable telling stories, the reason why I do what I do is because I want to give people that context and those frameworks to say, okay, yes, I can do this. I can get comfortable around it. But getting there is a big mindset shift. And I don't think it's talked about enough. I mean, we're going back to Amy Porterfield. She's a very, very accomplished, successful business owner, and she still struggles with the idea of sharing that vulnerable side of her. And so I think there's this mindset shift. And I have a quote that I use all the time, and I'm gonna butcher it, but it's people will use your stories as kind of a roadmap to survival. And so if you think about sharing your story as a way to service other people and serve a really helpful tip that will change their lives, that will transform their lives, it sort of takes the sting out of the vulnerability. It says, okay, what can I share that can actually help someone else? And that's just a small mindset shift, but it's what I think a lot of people don't talk about. You know, some people do, but I think there's also, you know, with younger generations, kind of millennials, et cetera, it comes more naturally because they're part of the sharing culture. When you're talking to people who are, you know, 40s, 50s, 60s, and you're trying to coach them on being vulnerable and sharing their stories, it doesn't come as naturally. It was not part of the social context when they were growing up. So it's a little bit of a harder and longer reach. And so I always try to encourage people to look at sharing stories as you're giving someone else a survival guide.
Yeah. I love that. Okay, good off the cuff answer, girl. Okay, I love it. So I love what you shared today. Thank you. Thank you so much for being so generous with your time and information. Where can people connect with you online to learn more about storytelling?
Yeah, thanks so much for having me. By the way, it was a gift. It was such a pleasure to chat with you, and I love listening to your podcast. So thank you. And people can connect with me on Instagram. I'm at Raw Strategy, or my website is rawstrategy.net. I'm on LinkedIn. I do have Lindsay Yaw is my maiden name, so I'm Lindsay Yaw Rogers on LinkedIn.
Okay, I'll link to all of those in the show notes so you guys can grab those along with the episodes that I mentioned, past episodes that share stories. You have a whole wealth of information here. So moving forward, raise your right hand and tell me you will commit to tell stories because you no longer have any excuses because you had a whole bank of resources here on the show. But continue to follow along. Be sure to tag us in your Instagram stories when you share what you learned today. Again, I'll link to both of our profiles in the show notes. Lindsay, thank you so much for being here. I can't wait to hear what stories come out of this episode because of this information.
Thank you so much for having me.
Of course. All right, bye friends. We'll see you in the next episode.
All right, take care.
Hey friends, thanks so much for listening to today's episode. If you liked what you had to hear and you're looking to make a bigger splash with your brand online, then you've got to check out my brand new free video training. You can get it over at heathersager.com/mini-training, where I'm going to teach you the 3 speaking strategies that every online business owner needs for this virtual world here in 2020. Hint, you don't have to be some big pro speaker to make speaking work for your business. Go grab it now, heathersager.com/mini-training, and I'll see you on the next episode.